The gunman then entered a back door and went down two short hallways and then into a classroom on the left-hand side.
In Uvalde, Texas, on May 24th, Salvatore Ramos killed 21 people, 19 elementary school students, and two teachers. In the morning, Ramos and his grandmother verbally fought over a phone bill, and later he fired a gun into her forehead, leaving his grandmother in critical condition. Then Ramos sent messages to a 15-year-old in Germany about him planning the school shooting 15 minutes before it happened. When Ramos arrived at Robb Elementary School, he pulled out an AR-15-style rifle and went into the school at 11:32 a.m. When he entered the classroom, he said, quote, "You are all going to die," end quote. Law enforcement officials were unable to enter the building when they arrived within 4 minutes because they were pinned down by gunfire. Just under an hour, a successful police raid led to Ramos's death. An investigation is being conducted on law enforcement officials and Ramos's premeditated shooting.
In a situation like this, there are multiple agencies that are investigating. Certainly the Texas Rangers have the lead, but they're working closely with the FBI, the local police department, as well as our Office of Professional Responsibility. And so there's a lot of information that has to be gathered from all the agents, all the officers that responded, as well as at the site.
21 victims died and 17 were injured following the Robb Elementary School shooting. I'm Claude T. Martinez, reporting for GSUTV.
Hello, and welcome to GSUTV. 32-year-old WNBA player Brittany Griner returns home from Russia after being wrongfully detained from last February's incident while traveling with a cannabis oil vape cartridge. Griner arrived a couple days ago. She went to Brooke Army Medical Center in San Antonio for a routine evaluation check after her release from Russia prison on Thursday. Griner was freed due to the United States and Russian prisoner swap. In the prisoner swap, Russia received a notorious convicted Russian arms dealer, Victor Bout. Victor Bout was serving a 25-year prison sentence in the United States on charges of conspiring to kill Americans, acquire and export anti-aircraft missiles, and provide material support to a terrorist group. It's unclear how long Griner will stay at the medical center or whether the Phoenix Mercury Center will return to the WNBA. Thanks for watching. This is Alex Gray with GSUTV.
Governor State University's campus has come a long way since it was established back in 1969. The university has a new 200-page plan that seeks to define the campus of the future. Take a look at GSU's impressive renovation plans. The facility's master plan will include the construction of a social justice institute, a soccer field, and a student center, which only touches on the surface of campus improvements to come. According to Vice President for Facilities Development and Management, John Potempo said, "We know that the university will require additional facilities and improvements to its existing physical resources to achieve its mission, vision, and strategic plan goals. The new library will include special space for the College of Business, the College of Health and Human Services, and the College of Education, with additional lecture halls to accommodate students." According to GSU News, updates to current buildings will include a new lobby for the Center for Performing Arts to make it more accessible. The plans also consider how to improve traffic flow throughout the campus. Better placement of walkways, parking lots, and roads will increase ease of movement and traffic flow throughout the campus. The $1.6 million funding for the Social Justice Institute has already been secured, and construction on the soccer field has already begun. "We are extremely excited for the future of GSU's campus and student body. As Potempo puts it, this would change GSU for decades." I'm Dante Corona, reporting for GSUTV.
Hi, and welcome to GSUTV. Today, Governor State University hosts post-election town hall dinner event. The event was held from 5 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. in the Hall of Honors. The event provided various foods, dessert, and refreshments to the participants who came to the event. The event started with a silent tribute to Chastity Simeon, who passed away last November. The host and participants held a moment of silence for her. Afterwards, we hear from the student speakers about why voting is important and what it means for them to vote.
"It was not always a privilege for people like me. Voting wasn't a privilege for most people in America, so it's like something that we all need to do no matter what, because it does shape who we are going to be in the future and what we're going to be able to do and everything like that. And, you know, if you don't vote, what are you doing? Like, what's the point of having that whole fight that we all had to do in order to get to where we wanted to be? And then things are going to turn around and everything. Nobody wants that. So you guys, vote. It's important. It's not something you could just blow off. And you also have to understand what you're voting for, too, because you can't just go vote because everybody's voting for A or B. You got to vote for who you believe in. Don't be peer pressured. And, you know, yeah, that's it.
Thank you.
Next, the audience participated in a voting response where everyone wrote why it was vital for them to vote. When he finished writing it, they would share it with the audience.
Voting is important to me because I am human, I have rights, I have a voice, and I pay a whole lot of taxes.
We interview Professor Crystal Harris, who hosted a post-election town hall dinner event, and the person who put everything together for this event. We asked her what the event was about.
So this event was the post-election town hall dinner and discussion. Mm-hmm. And the goal of tonight was to really celebrate the work that we did all semester in the midterm election in getting students engaged, educated, prepared, pledging to vote, showing up to vote.
We also asked her what the importance of voting for her was.
Well, for me, I come from a family that was engaged. We're from the South, Montgomery, Alabama, and my parents were active in the civil rights movement. So I grew up hearing about this, but it wasn't until I became a professor and saw how a lot of people really had not been exposed to voting, and voting wasn't normalized in a part of their culture. And I saw that as an opportunity to learn more about how I could make a difference in that. So that's really how I got started.
We talked to Marquise Parks about why it's essential to vote.
Yeah, so the importance of voting is to make sure that your voice is heard. If you're educated on why your vote matters, then, you know, it gives more impact to the election that comes up.
Afterwards, we ask him why it's crucial to attend these events.
So events like these are coalition movements to ensure that students and all members of our community know that our votes matter as much as we need them to. So we partner with our local officials to make sure that, you know, they're providing the right amount of addressing our concerns that we have. So if we, you know, follow up with those officials and make sure that we are voting the right people, then we can have these concerns addressed appropriately.
If you are interested in learning more about these events, please check your school email for upcoming events, or you can email gsuvotes.gov.edu for more information. Thank you for watching. This is Alex Gray with GSUTV.
Beyond Conversation, Red Summer had a preview event and an open discussion about the 1919 race riots in Chicago. Kicking off the event was the short segment of the play, Red Summer, created by Shepsu Aku and Andrew White. Center for Performing Arts visitors saw a glimpse of the events before the rioting. The racial tensions in Chicago intensified during the Great Migration, and Eugene Williams fell victim. On July 27, 1919, Eugene was struck in the head by a rock and drowned in Lake Michigan. This is because of the invisible line. Racial groups in Chicago identified the invisible line by seeing the opposite race, and if they crossed, they would be subject to being attacked. George Starber was the perpetrator, killing Eugene with a rock, but Starber dodged charges. What followed next was 8 days of rioting, causing 38 deaths and 500 injuries. Political science major Chastity Simeon discussed her findings about Red Summer.
One takeaway that I know now is the incident of the beach, where Eugene was an individual that was killed during this period based off the invisible line. And it was kind of breathtaking and actually emotional, tragic experience.
Simeon adds her thoughts on how we can be a better community to others.
Just speak to someone different from you. Literally be open and optimistic to change and to diversity. This is important for us to learn a different perspective and livelihood of a different individual other than ourselves or our cultural backgrounds.
Principal and editorial director Walter M. Perkins talked about the importance of knowing your history.
Our young people need to be more connected
to their history. It gives them a better sense of who they are, what their ancestors have done, and just the whole richness that they come out of. It's not being done with those discussions are not happening often enough within families.
Mr. Perkins also shares how the older generation can better inform young people.
Share a book that you've read and give it to somebody. And then after they've read it, talk to them about it. A couple of times during the program today, the word context was used. And our young people, they don't have any context. They mostly deal with their own peers, and they don't have any much in the way of top-down information in terms of how things really are, and when things happen to them, how to evaluate those things in terms of their lives.
Actresses Lauren Welsman and Chloe Belangelo explained the importance of telling the Red Summer story to the public.
Even though it's a dark story to tell, it's still fun. And so with the fun, there's humanness that comes with the characters as well. And so seeing themselves in a way, so I think that's important. I know for myself, I didn't even know that this happened until in the last few years. These sort of stories are important, and I think being able to see it in a way that's theatrical, that's fun, that you can sing and dance, kind of eases the trauma of it all.
I think it definitely teaches us that two things can be true at once. Something can be hopeful and tragic at the same time, and I think we all felt that the first time we did a cast reading of the show and we said those words out loud.
To see the full premiere production of Red Summer, be sure to save the date, which will be held the third and fourth weekend at the CPA in September. For more information about Red Summer, please visit govst.edu/redsummer. Thank you for watching. This is Claude T. Martinez for GSUTV.
What's up, everybody? My name is Dante Corona, and this is the first episode of GSU Fit, where we're going to show you how to get strong and feel healthy. Today, I'm with my partner, John Redfield, and we're going to take you through a full body routine here at the gym. So without further ado, let's get into it.
So first, John is doing a stretch for his quads before he hits his Bulgarian split squats. Notice that he's standing on a plate. He does this to raise his heel, which puts more emphasis on the quad. This is a difficult exercise, but it's great for growing those legs. You can also hit goblet squats to target the legs, which is where you squat in place while holding a dumbbell. Or you can squat in place with no dumbbell. Both are great for legs. Now, let's work the upper body.
Alright, so I'm going to show you how to hit a very, very effective shoulder workout. It's called lateral raises. So, when you're doing these, you want to make sure that you got lightweight, focus on bringing your elbows up, just like that. Remember, lightweight, slow and controlled, get those nice defined shoulders. Just like that. Yeah.
This is how you do a proper mid-chest workout with a dumbbell press. What you want to do is that you want to grab your dumbbells, rest them on your leg, then when you're about to fall back, before you fall back, you want to roll your shoulders back. So all the emphasis is on your back, you push up, and it powers through your chest. Roll your shoulders back, and then once you are about to fall back, you can lift them up with your knees, and then push through all the way up and squeeze at the top, just like this. You wanna come down slow, and back up. You wanna go down slow, and back up. You want to make sure it's an arch in your back. Go down, squeeze back up at the top.
Now John will demonstrate an incline chest press.
You want to go down slow and controlled and push back up. Slow and controlled, push back up.
Alright, so now we're going to go ahead and work out back. And what I'm going to do first is I'm going to do some rows. Probably some of the best exercises you could do for your back is going to include some sort of row movement. So right now I'm on the machine. I'm just going to come in and squeeze, come back, squeeze. Make sure you've got that mind-muscle connection. And just keep squeezing every time you come back. Nice, slow, and controlled.
Now let's hit those arms. I'm hitting bicep curls with the straight bar. I would suggest hitting your curls with the straight bar for ultimate bicep contraction. For this exercise, you can do 10 to 12 reps for 3 to 4 sets. For triceps, I like to do overhead movements like skull crushers.
Lift up. You want to make sure that you're not hitting it like this, because you're not hitting anything up here. At an angle,
we're here.
Down, stay at the angle, down again, right there. And that's really good tricep work. Thank you for joining us on this episode of GSU Fit. On the next episode, we're going to show you how to get a crazy at-home workout. Until next time, we'll see you in the next one. I'm Dante Corona reporting for GSU TV.
Today on GSU TV, the International Service Office celebrates Dandia Night and Pathkama in the Hall of Governors. The event was held from 4 p.m. to 9 p.m. Dandia Night is a celebration of the victory mythical goddess Durga over the terrible demon Mahishasura. On this day, young and older people from around India come together and dance with Dandia's color sticks to imitate the great battle. Dandia Night also celebrates the divine feminine that spans 9 nights and 10 days each year. Pathkama is a colorful floral festival of Telangana and is celebrated by women folk with exotic flowers of the region. Over the years, the festival became a symbol of Telangana culture and identity. Pathkama comes during later half of the monsoon before the onset of winter. Towards the end of the event, the International Service Office provided authentic Indian cuisine for participants who came into the event or anyone nearby to enjoy it. If you are interested in learning more about the International Service events, please check your school email for upcoming events or head to www.govs.edu/IOS for more information. Thank you for watching. This is Alex Gray with GSU TV.
Welcome to GSU TV, where today we are talking about the April Fool's Drive that happened this past week, and also having a conversation with the coordinator, Miss Sierra Noel.
April Food Day is an annual event sponsored by United Way. And basically what United Way does is give away so much food to local food pantries and so forth. So Governor State happens to be one of those pantries. Maya Hardy, who is a GSU alum, is actually one of the organizers of the event. So it's very nice to have her expertise when trying to plan this event. So this is actually my first year participating in this event and coordinating for GSU. So I think it's a great way to give for companies and organizations to give back to Governor State and to local food pantries as well, just to be a positive impact on the community. Well, we have so many volunteers who came out this year to help us just to sort and organize, as well as unload the truck with the food and stock it into our food pantry. But food insecurity is a very, very important issue right now, especially with inflation, especially with the pandemic, and so many people not knowing where their next meal might come from. So this is a very good way to ensure that we're helping our neighbors, helping our fellow students, staff, local communities, and so forth, to make sure they have the resources that they need during these times.
The food drive was a success, and everybody who came out to help had a big impact in society. This is John Redfield, and thank you for watching GSU TV.
If you are attending community college in the Chicagoland area and plan to seek a bachelor's degree after graduation, then you may be eligible for the dual degree program. Governor State University has partnered with multiple community colleges to assist students in earning quality and affordable associate and bachelor's degrees.
So the dual degree program is a partnership with 17 community colleges in the Chicagoland area that allows students to be involved in Governor State early in their experience while completing their associate's degree, have a seamless transfer over to Governor State, and finish the bachelor's degree in the shortest amount of time possible. So with the dual degree program, joining the earlier the better, because you do lock in Governor State's tuition rate at the time of joining DDP. And then also, we waive your application fee, we have guaranteed admissions to Governor State, and also have the opportunity to compete for exclusive scholarships that are only available to dual degree program students. We have a GSU Promise Scholarship for students who are typically Pell eligible and have at least a 2.75 GPA, and then also the DDP Honors Scholarship for students with a 3.5 and have been members of their Community College Honors Program or members of Phi Theta Kappa. It's a two-year scholarship, covers full tuition and fees here at Governor State.
The dual degree program locks in tuition at GSU and offers even more help to students.
A couple other benefits for the dual degree program is students are assigned a designated transfer specialist to assist in their academic advising prior to coming to Governor State to make sure each of their credits will transfer and they're graduating in the shortest amount of terms possible. And also throughout that experience, students are invited to different social engagements, honorary courting ceremonies to acknowledge the completion of those 2 degrees, and are just part of the GSU family throughout that entire process. Easy to sign up and it's free. So all you have to do is go online and complete our dual degree program enrollment form, which is on off of our website. You're able to link that from our website. Complete that form, attach unofficial transcripts if you're able. We approve it at our end to verify that students are definitely enrolled at their community college, and then you're in. Prairie State College student Manuel Reza started as a transfer student, came over here to Governor State through the dual degree program. When he finished, he graduated early with his bachelor's degree and then became actually our graduate assistant within the program and continues to work with us now and is now graduating with his master's and moving on to a doctoral program this fall.
So, as you search for your next university, don't forget about the dual degree program at GSU.
So it's, again, it's family. And once you're part of DDP, we try to make sure that you go beyond the dual degrees.
This is Dante Corona reporting for GSU TV.
Good morning. I'm Jason Gonzalez coming from the 2022 Chicago Thanksgiving Parade. On November 24th, 2022, thousands of people lined up at 8 a.m. along the iconic State Street to celebrate the 88th year of the Chicago Thanksgiving Day Parade. Its initial start was delayed due to some technical difficulties with production. The 1 hour long delay did not stop the festivities from being at full effect. The parade contained eye-catching performances, floats, and marching bands from around the Chicagoland area. Overall, the parade kicked off the holiday season in the heart of downtown Chicago. I'm Jason Gonzalez reporting for Governor State University News.
This is Jazmine Grisby reporting to you from what was formerly known as Ritchie's High School, but is now reported to be the site of the new state-of-the-art Career and Technical Center that will serve the South Suburbs as the Southland Career and Technical Education Center.
According to E! News Park Forest, the school will provide thousands of students training across 6 occupational areas such as aviation, construction trades, information technology, manufacturing trades, public safety, and urban agriculture by licensed educators and professionals within the field. Ideas for the center are being promoted by several local educational institutions such as Bloom Township, Crete Monique, Homewood Flossmoor, Southland College Prep, and Prairie State College. The institutions involved, known as the Collective, are hoping to receive funding through grants and other various sources in order to fund the $100 million project. There hadn't been much talk regarding the building since back in October of 2019, when according to ABC 7, the Rich Township District 227 voted to close the former high school due to what was said to be a decline in enrollment and the building's need for repairs that would cost the district millions.
If funding is approved, within 3 to 5 years, we could be seeing a brand new building and vocational technical school at this very site. Reporting to you for Governor State University, I'm Jazmine Grisby.
I'm seeing something no one else can see except for me. It's smiling at me.
Welcome to Hollywood Buzz. This is your host, Dante Corona. And I'm going to get you up to speed on all the latest news and rumors in the entertainment industry. Like how beloved actor Jason Momoa cut his hair as we gear up for his return to Aquaman. We have plenty of news and content to cover, so without further ado, let's get into it. It's officially spooky season, which means it's time for a scare. The highly anticipated new horror film Smile
follows the life of a doctor who begins experiencing unknown terror after having a frightening encounter with a patient. Smile is set for release on September 30th.
I want to be loved from as many people as possible. But truth is, I'm not really a good person.
Pearl is another slasher flick which was released on September 16th. Mia Goth reprises her role as the villain Pearl, a character that debuted in the 2022 film X.
Wow.
Andrew Collins, you go by Drew, right? Welcome home. I've been designed and programmed to cater to your every need.
Margot is an advanced AI house system. Unfortunately for this group, Margot is not what she seems, as she also has sinister plans for these teens. You can watch Margot now on Prime Video. And let's not forget about one of America's oldest horror maniacs, Michael Myers. Halloween Ends is set for an October 14th release date.
Shaving off the hair.
Jason Momoa is known for his dashing good looks and great hair. Fans lost their minds when he chopped off the famous locks.
Oh man.
But Momoa did it for a great cause.
I'm tired of these plastic bottles. We gotta stop. Plastic forks, all that goes into our land, goes into our ocean.
That was the worst pep talk ever.
The actor shaved off his beard 3 years ago for the same cause, as he continues his efforts to protect the environment. Justin Bieber has canceled the remainder of his Justice World tour. The singer has decided to take a break and focus on his health, as it's only been months since he had announced he had Ramsay-Hunt syndrome, a virus that causes paralysis on one side of the face. Bieber assured his fans via Instagram that he is going to be okay.
We have a great team and cast of people that have come onto this and believe in it and put their whole heart and soul into it.
Chadwick Boseman has won a posthumous Emmy on Saturday, September 3rd, during the 74th Creative Arts Emmy Awards for his excellent voice acting in Marvel's What If series. Boseman played Star-Lord T'Challa in the second episode of the show, streaming now on Disney+.
My brother gave his life hunting the enemy. His task is now mine.
The Lord of the Rings, Rings of Power, released on Prime Video on September 1st. For the first time, Prime Video revealed a viewing tally. According to the company, Rings of Power was streamed by 25 million people worldwide. At the Creative Arts Emmy Awards, Barack Obama won Outstanding Narrator for his work on Our Great National Parks, a Netflix original which focuses on U.S. national parks and wildlife. Kelly Clarkson is headed to the Hollywood Walk of Fame. The Grammy-winning artist and Emmy-winning talk show host will be inducted in the recording category.
Pushing through the physical barriers can be transformative. Pushing through the mental barriers is a transcendent experience.
Have you ever wondered how an elite adventure athlete trains and eventually embarks on their incredible adventures? Well, you can see for yourself now in The Edge of the Unknown, streaming now on Disney+.
Someone's bugging you. What is it?
Sometimes kids say bad words about the black kids.
Who's that?
Somebody from my old school.
Did they ever come to your house?
What'd you do when that happens?
Obviously nothing, of course.
You think that's smart?
Here's a look at Armageddon Time, a film inspired by writer-director James Gray's childhood in 1980s Queens, New York. Anne Hathaway, Jeremy Strong, Banks Rapetta, Jalen Webb, and Anthony Hopkins star in the drama, which opens in select theaters on October 28th. That's it for this month's episode of Hollywood Buzz. Thank you for tuning in. And don't forget to come back for episode 3 coming out next month. I'm Dante Corona, reporting for GSUTV.